It is a very good day to celebrate if you are a MLS soccer fan. All kinds of crazy stuff happening. This is the Playing for 90 Soccer Show. Baxter Colburn here with you on a special edition of the show. Usually the show only broadcasts on Monday nights, but because of all the crazy stuff that happened in MLS yesterday, we felt it was necessary here at Playing for 90 to have another show just to kind of recap everything that happened, just to keep you, the avid soccer fan, understanding of what's all really going on. I'm Baxter Colburn here with you. Don't mind the dogs in the background if you do hear any barking. It's just part of having animals at your place, so, and not having soundproof walls. So minor things. It's little things in life. So if you hear them chiming in occasionally, do not fret. I am not broadcasting live from a remote studio or anything at a dog pound. So unfortunately. So yeah, MLS soccer, crazy last 36 hours really. It was a really busy time, even just for our site in general, playingfor90.com. You can find us on Twitter at playingfor90. You can also find us on Facebook just by searching playingfor90 as well. Playingfor90, a general soccer site, giving you the very best in analysis and opinions from all over the soccer world, from MLS to Champions League to EPL to national teams to NWSL to Timmy's little co-ed rec soccer team with the YMC. Well, maybe not that, but you never know. You know, that's the beauty of the general soccer site. But anyway, jumping in, just not a very long show for you today, but just like you said, we kind of want to recap everything, voice some opinions about everything going on in Major League Soccer. It was a cascade of events yesterday, within the last 36 hours, because it really all kind of started in terms of when you know what hit the fan with Mix Diskerud, his name popping up now as a potential candidate to head to NYCFC to pair with Mr. Frank Lampard in the midfield. But at this point, Frank Lampard wouldn't join the team until the summer, so Diskerud, the latest U.S. men's national team player to be rumored to be heading to Major League Soccer, could be headed to the new expansion side, NYCFC. Right now, I believe that people of NYCFC are just so desperate to get a decent player in their team that will draw a lot of people to the stadium that isn't Frank Lampard, that honestly they don't really care who it is. Not to say that Mix Diskerud is not a good player, because he is. He's a very good player. We've seen him do well for the U.S. men's national team. Jurgen Klinsmann does like Diskerud, although Diskerud did make the World Cup roster. He did not see a single second of any game during the four games that the U.S. men's national team played. Irrelevant to this conversation. Well, it isn't, but it is. Because Diskerud is now looking to find his niche again, and Major League Soccer is an untested ground for him, and he feels like this would be a good opportunity for himself to get back out and really take his career in a positive direction. So NYCFC, like I said, they're looking for a savior now that the whole Frank Lampard fiasco is kind of boiled over within reason. It's already decided Lampard will not join the team until the summer of the 2015 season. So Mix Diskerud could be the next man up in that regards. Staying in the New York area, now I did just lie to you, unfortunately, in terms of Diskerud being the newest and latest U.S. men's national team product to potentially head stateside, because that was the truth. That was the truth until yesterday afternoon when Taylor Twellman dropped a bomb on the Twitter world saying that U.S. men's national team product and former New York Red Bulls striker Jozy Altidore could be heading back to Major League Soccer. I know, I'm just as surprised as you are, and this is something that I have been calling for the last 2 years, saying that Jozy Altidore needs to get his butt out of Europe and come back to MLS, where he had a lot of success, and find his scoring niche again, because it was obvious he was not finding any success over in Europe. He had one good season for the same team that Aaron Johansson plays for now, and everybody thought he was great. He went to Hull City, he went to Sunderland. He's been at Sunderland the last two seasons now, including this one. He has appeared in 11 games. He's only got 7 shots, 0 goals this season. Jozy, as a friend, Jozy, you got to come back. You got to come back. You got to come to MLS. Twellman is always a very good source in terms of latest MLS news. He had his tweet yesterday. Just a direct quote from him. He says, "Multiple sources tell me Jozy Altidore and MLS are in discussions about his return this winter with three teams applying." And then he hashtags Toronto FC, the New York Red Bulls, and the Portland Timbers. All three teams in the market for a striker. Toronto FC harboring Jermaine Defoe, but Defoe looking to go on loan to Queen's Park Rangers or Leicester City in the English Premier League till the end of their EPL season, would not be available then for the first half of the 2015 Major League Soccer season. So having Altidore come in to fill the gap and pair along with Gilberto, you've got all different kinds of Michael Bradley, but at the same time, a lot of people are assuming that he will not go to TFC because MLS probably does not want two of their biggest names on the same team, because then, you know, they're not really spacing up the talent, the league is not really growing. But at the same accord, we saw Julio Cesar, we saw Michael Bradley, we saw Jermaine Defoe all go to TFC last season, and then Julio Cesar left for the World Cup break after TFC started the season super hot. TFC really fell out of favor in Major League Soccer and did not live up to the hype of what their preseason hopes had been, which was unfortunate because they do know how to score goals. They did a really good job of it last year, but could not make the playoffs to save their life. So an addition of Altidore could be in the works sooner rather than later. Looking at Portland Timbers, they just recently re-signed Gaston Fernandez, one of their crucial forwards on that team. He had a good season last year. Having Altidore being able to pair up with him, and then you have Diego Valeri as well, Darlington Nagbe, a lot of power, a lot of speed, could lead to that. And it's ironic because maybe a few hours before this article, this rumor of Altidore coming back, 2 hours before that, Chris Blakely, one of the writers, or one of the editors here at PlayingFor90.com, released an article on FanSided saying that the Portland Timbers were in the market to secure a U.S. men's national team player in 2015 before the Altidore news even broke. So nobody had any idea about this. But now that we see the fact that Portland was looking to bring in a U.S. men's national team product, and now that we see that Twellman is reporting that Altidore might be going to Portland, it's kind of like putting two and two together. It would be a good fit in that regards. And then obviously you've got the New York Red Bulls, who just lost Thierry Henry. Tim Cahill, nobody knows what's really going on with him. Then you've got the 2014 leading goal scorer in MLS, Bradley Wright Phillips, sitting with no one really to match up with him in the same skill set that he has. Yeah, you've got Sire, Sen, Peggy Lulandela, those other talented midfielders, Dax McCarty. But at the same record, they don't have someone that can go up top and pair with BWP the same way that Henri could. So adding Altidore back to the squad would be really beneficial, and it would really heat things up between the Red Bulls and NYCFC if that happened. Wow, that was a lot of stuff. And we're not even done yet. But we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we'll give you some more. This is the Playing for 90 Soccer Show. Don't go anywhere. I'd like to put on my boogie shoes. It's always a good time here at the Playing for 90 Soccer Show. Baxter Colburn here with you, your host, one of the editors here at PlayingFor90.com. Ah, boogie, woogie, oogie. I love a good old ballroom dance, swing dance festival. But we're talking about soccer. We're not talking about dancing. Anyway, back to the issue at hand, all of the news that broke in Major League Soccer over the last 36 hours, just kind of a crazy cluster of news that broke all at once. I don't know if they planned it that way or what, but MLS was hot yesterday, and people are still recovering from all of the work that they had to go through just to cover everything that happened yesterday. Going into yesterday, the biggest news story that people were hoping for was the release of the 2015 MLS schedule. That's all it was. Everybody was like, okay, cool, the new schedule comes out tomorrow, we can finally see what's going to happen, see if the league made any changes. And sure enough, the schedule did come out, but then everything else happened at the same time as well. So, focusing more now on the schedule, going into the 20th season, which will now be for Major League Soccer, which is an incredible feat in any regards. Anytime a sports league, a professional top flight sports league, can last 20 or more years is always a very good sign for the growth and the management of the league as well. Going now into the playoffs, kind of diving a little bit more into it, into the schedule, is that the playoff field has now been expanded. So for some of those teams that just missed the boat in 2014 or any other season, basically, in Major League Soccer, your team now has one more shot to get in. So as the playoff field has expanded to 12 teams, as the sixth place teams in both the East and West Conference will now qualify for the postseason, the way it works now, though, is that there will be knockout rounds that will consist of four single elimination matches on the road to MLS Cup. So if you thought your team was already going to be super tired by sneaking into one of those bottom spots in Major League Soccer, they're going to have to go through even more to try to beat and claw their way through. So it's going to be crucial to get one of those top two or three spots now, because that's going to be one of the only ways that your team is really going to be able, it's going to be crucial to get one of the top two spots in either conference, because you're actually going to be able to get a little bit of rest before everything goes crazy for you. Which might work out well for some teams, it might not for others, because that way they can stay hot, they can stay consistent, and really start to take over, depending on how their teams do going into that part of the postseason. It was interesting because now that there are 21 teams in Major League Soccer, I'm sorry, 20 teams. MLS is 20 teams. I know how to read. I promise I do. Major League Soccer, each team will play 34 games during the regular season. That'll combine for a total of 340 total matches in Major League Soccer just in regular season play, which I think is remarkable. 34 games. Some people think it's too long. Some people think it's too short. I'm kind of on the fence with that. I think 34 games is a bit much, because you consider the regular season starts in March, and they end the season with the final in December. So that is a bit of a long haul if your team is fortunate enough to make it. There is breaks in there, of course. There's the All-Star break. There's all kinds of stuff that happens in there. So they're not playing constant all the way through. But to any avail, that still is a lot of soccer to be played in that period of time. So some of the other big things that did happen, though, as with the schedule being announced, there will be two more weekends of high-profile rivalry games for the first time in league history, which is very exciting. There is a unprecedented slate of nationally televised games as well. ESPN, Fox Sports 1, and Univision as well. All will be broadcasting games. So there'll be a lot of different opportunities for you to catch your favorite teams in that regards. I know that I, as a New England Revolution fan, that live in Wisconsin, have a difficult time watching the Revolution because they are never televised. But now that they did good last season, everyone's like, oh, we should give them more national television. Oh, perfect. Well, which is what they're going to do March 8th against the Seattle Sounders on Fox Sports 1. So you better believe I'm going to be watching that game. Woo, I can't wait for the season. I'm excited. Anybody else excited for Major League Soccer 2015? Because I am. I am jazzed and I am ready to roll for that. Anyway, sorry. You know, sometimes you can't contain your excitement. You know, kind of like with DeAndre Yedlin going to Tottenham. A lot of Sounders fans were upset about that. But the good news is that DeAndre Yedlin chose his new number for the Tottenham Hotspurs, currently sitting in fifth place in the EPL table. Yedlin chose a number that means a lot to the city of Seattle. He chose the number 12. Now, for some of you, you're probably like, well, what does that have to do with anything? He was number 17 when he was at Seattle. He was number 2 for the U.S. men's national team. Why? What does 12 have to do with anything? Well, anybody that's outside of Seattle does not really grasp the relevance of that. But back in 1984, the city of Seattle and the Seattle Seahawks retired the number 12 jersey in honor of their fans, hence the 12th man when you go to Seattle Seahawks games. And the fact that the Seahawks and the Sounders share the same stadium, the 12th man style of play, the 12th man persona, all goes together. So now that Yedlin is taking the number 12 from Seattle over to London with him, so now that he will carry the same tradition on. Obviously, it's different because Seattle and Tottenham are not the same thing by any means, but this gives Yedlin an opportunity to almost thank the city of Seattle for all it gave him as he now moves on with his career in London, which is terrific. Even better news, though, for Yedlin is that he might be seeing the field sooner rather than later for Tottenham, because the Spurs have 6 games remaining before the month of January is finished, which is a lot considering the EPL. Usually they play 1 game a week, 3 to 4 games a month, no big deal. But the fact that there are 6 games remaining, they play 1 FA Cup game and a two-leg league semi-final. They have a two-leg League Cup semi-final against Sheffield United. So there'll be 3 games where they'll be playing weaker opponents in that regards. So Yedlin might get a chance to sneak in. They also play Sunderland, who is in 4th place. And then you also have some other games coming up for them that really just aren't against high-quality opponents that could see Yedlin sneak into either the starting 11 or become a super sub off the bench. One interesting thing, though, is that the Spurs do have 14 defenders on their roster now with the addition of Yedlin, so finding out if he will actually get playing time will be hard to know just because of that many people crowding the back line. So, Yedlin, he's moving on. I think the move for Yedlin is a terrific idea. Yes, he only spent 2 seasons in Major League Soccer, but he did enough to get a U.S. Men's National Team call-up to the World Cup during that point in time. He played in World Cup action, and now he has earned himself a trip over to the EPL, where he will take on the likes of Eden Hazard, Wayne Rooney, Radim Falcao. It's going to be a long list of people he's going to have to slow down. Maybe even Lionel Messi. That's just a whole other rumor. But anyway, he now has a chance to play at the highest level possible in the English Premier League and hone his skills at only the young age of 21 and potentially grow into one of the best defenders in the world and all time for the U.S. men's national team. I know that's asking a lot, but it is possible. With that, one more quick break, come back, gonna talk a little bit more MLS news, and we'll go from there.
Well, this ain't no lost and found. I got just one deal to make, and then I'll be trouble bound. They say that you're a dog, that with you I'll keep on winning. I think they're talking about the kind of doll that you stick pins in. You're my hoodoo voodoo doll. You're my hoodoo voodoo doll. Now, baby, if you keep on sinning, I'll just stick another pin in. You're my hoodoo voodoo doll.
I wonder if Cristiano Ronaldo has a hoodoo voodoo doll. Seems like something weird that he would do. He's got all kinds of weird traditions and stuff that he does. But, you know, that's just a whole nother thing. But staying on Ronaldo for a second, don't know if you heard it or not. Recently, it was revealed that Cristiano Ronaldo is entertaining moving to Major League Soccer. But don't get too excited, because he is not thinking of coming until about 2018, when his contract at Real Madrid is up. But, you know, he was stated the other day as saying that after his contract in 2018 has expired, perhaps he will go to the United States, but only God knows what will happen, which is a very true statement. Hence the reason, like I ended last show, saying that God is a soccer fan, because he is, because there's no other beautiful game like that of soccer. It would be interesting to see if Cristiano Ronaldo and Lionel Messi, when they're both about, 45 and still probably better than most of Major League Soccer, decide to come over and play in MLS, whether it's together or separately. That would be a good reunion to have both of them finally put aside their differences, finally play on the same team for once, and see what kind of impact that would have. They should both come play for the Revolution. That's my personal opinion. I think all the other Revolution fans out there agree. Okay, that's not going to happen. But either way, staying with the New England Revolution for a second, a news story broke today that Emmanuel Adebayor is now considering a move to Major League Soccer. Now, as I was reading the article from NBC Sports, the first thing that the article stated was that the 31-year-old is looking to come to Major League Soccer. I'm like, okay, that's cool, you know, a new forward. And immediately, I start thinking, oh, well, the New England Revolution need a forward. Maybe they'll mention it in the article and say, hey, you know, he could move to there, he could pair with Jermaine Jones, Diego Fagundes, Lee Wynn, all those cool guys, you know? Awesome. As I kept reading the article, it says that Toronto FC would be the perfect landing place for Adebayor. At this point, all it seems is that if there's a forward for hire in Major League Soccer, especially in the Eastern Conference, the New England Revolution completely get overlooked, which is ridiculous and completely unfair in my opinion. Because you look at the team like the Revolution, who host an incredible amount of talent in their midfield, and then you look up top, they have Charlie Davies, and that's about it, because they got rid of Patrick Mullins, foolishly. They sent him, they didn't protect him, and now New York City FC signed him, and he is going to probably have a terrific career with them, which is fine. I'm a Patrick Mullins fan, good for him. But at the same regards, it's a little unnerving that every time a new forward becomes available, yes, he's 31, but Adebayor could still add a lot of depth to the Revolution. Same with Jozy Altidore. It just depends on the Revolution, though, because the Revolution are traditionally known, much like my favorite football team, the Green Bay Packers, for not doing a whole lot during the transfer season, which is fine, but it's very annoying at the same time, because somebody like myself, who when I play FIFA, I destroy the transfer season because I am always moving people around. Anyway, that's just a personal preference. Either way, I think that Adebayor and or Altidore should really be on the Revolution's radar because they do need a forward. You ask any New England Revolution fan, the biggest need going into the 2015 season is one or two more decent to top flight forwards. That's the truth. That is the honest truth. You talk to anybody else. I have contacts at ESPN Boston, New England Soccer Today. Any Revolution fan you talk to, they're going to tell you the same thing. A forward is the number one thing the Revolution need going into the 2015 season. Charlie Davies is a great forward, but he's not the best forward in Major League Soccer, and he doesn't deserve a U.S. Men's National Team call-up yet either. That was another debate that happened a while ago. Anyway, I'm done ranting. This is not the Baxter's Rant for 30 Minutes show. This is the Playing for 90s Soccer show. A big show we had today, all kinds of MLS news that broke over the last 36 hours. I'm Baxter Colburn, it's been a blast. As always, keep it real, keep it fun, and remember, God is a soccer fan.